Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you there. I didn't mean to distract you from your fishing. I just saw the concentrated look on your face, and I was drawn over here. Oh, don't be fearful. I'm not a siren. I swear, I'm not a siren. I'm not that good at humming. I'm just a merfolk. Honestly, I promise you have my word that I would never drag a living being into this ocean if it could not breathe in the waters. I promise. And if you're unsure, I would stay back here in the water. Why was I drawn to you? Well, I mean, the concentrated look on your face. I've never seen someone just so concentrated when working with the waters before. It's amazing. I mean, usually when I see fishermen or women working with the waters, they're sloppy or they're angry at the seas because they won't bring them what they want, yet you. Even when your net comes back empty, you have just look concentrated on working harder and not blaming it on the sea. Oh, how rude of me. I should introduce myself. My name's Katrina. Katrina Merfolk. Yeah, I know. Cliche, I'm a merfolk in my last name's Merfolk, but, well, that's the name I have. Well, it's nice to meet you, too. Even if it's by surprise. Though I'd appreciate it if you maybe didn't tell, anyone you met me from the land. Oh, no. It's just that a lot of people in the land don't like us, and assume that we are the same as sirens, and, well, you know, I'd rather not have people hunting me down with spears and forks and, what's that word again? Oh, fire. That's the thing that burns, right? I knew it. Sorry, I've been studying land dwellers' kind of terminology lately. It's just that sometimes it can be really lonely. I don't talk to many people a lot of the time, and, well, people down there can be kind of boring. So, being able to come up here and talk to land dwellers is exciting, especially when they want to talk back. I mean, sometimes they yell and throw stuff, and other times they run away screaming. Sorry, I'm babbling here. Oh, you've heard of me before? From the children? Really? Oh, please do not get the wrong idea. I'm not trying to cause any harm to those children. Not one bit. It's just that one day I was sitting on a rock, and I was telling a story to one of my sisters, because she was a little scared about sitting, you know, in clear view with me in case someone threw something at us. And some children who were by the seashore swam out to us, and they listened in on the story, and, well, since then I've kind of told stories from the sea to them, and you're not mad? You want to hear one? Really? I mean, well, you're kind of the first land dweller over the age of a child that's ever asked me to tell a story. Do you really mean it? I'd love to. Oh, though, please, let me just think of a story that's age appropriate. I don't really want to be telling you about the little flounder that found a little coin, or the seagull that saved a fish from an octopus. Those are just a little childish. And I don't need a moment to compose myself. I've never been able to tell a story to someone who's, well, you look my age, so I'll take it that you are. Okay. What kind of story to tell? Story. I got one. Oh, it's a brilliant one. Though, I hope you enjoy it too. Are you comfortable where you are? Would you mind if I just move to that rock? Thanks. I don't really want to try and be swimming the entire time while telling a story. Okay, let me just pop up here. Oh, there we go. Much more comfortable. Okay. Now, let me think how to set this tale in motion. I've got it. There once was a young man, and his name doesn't matter to the story, but what matters is his love for the ocean. The young man of the town by the sea loved the ocean. Anytime he could, to the waves and gently run his hand up and down them as if petting the finest pet, caressing each little splash of water with his fingertips in such a loving way. The people of the town thought he was a bit odd doing this, yet he caused no one any harm, so they let him be. However, although the townspeople noticed, they were not the only ones to notice his odd behaviors. The queen of the sea, Oceana, had seen him do this. She watched how he would lay by the sea at night if he could, and how by day he would fish so carefully, making sure not to harm anything too much. And slowly, she fell in love with him. The man who loved the sea one day met a woman. And this woman on the land loved the sea as much as he. And soon both ran their hands up and down the waves in the morning and lay by it at night. They knew they were meant to be together, and they cared for each other just as much as they cared for the sea. And so, they proclaimed their love, so happy and joyful. However, Oceana was not happy to see this. She was infuriated with how the man she loved had been snatched away, without her ever having a chance to talk to him. And so Oceana found a sea urchin from the very bottom depths of the sea, and she made a deal so that she could have the man that she'd always dreamed of, the man who loved the sea as much as she. And only she could have him. man and the woman he loved went to the sea once again and ran their fingertips up and down the waves. However, the man was called by one of his friends to help him with his fishing net. He told his love that he would be right back, and so he left. However, when he returned to talk to his love once more, all he found were her shoes and the sand filled with water. She was nowhere to be seen. Oceana watched as he looked around wildly, but she knew that he would never find her. She knew where she was, but she wouldn't tell him ever. That night, the man who loved the sea lay with salty tears in his eyes until suddenly a creature emerged from the water. Looking up, he saw the most beautiful woman he'd ever seen. Though he was not enchanted by her charms as much as he'd been enchanted by his love. Oceana looked at him as she rised above the water, her tail still within the waves. "Man," she said softly, "please come to me. I've watched the way you've touched my waves, and watched the way you've loved the sea. Please come with me." But he shook his head. "I cannot be with you, for my love is missing. And I love my love more than I love the sea." Oceana was more enraged than ever by this. And so, with the powers that she had over the sea, she used waves to splash upon the shore to bring her closer to the man, and used seaweed to wrap around his legs. "You cannot love her," she said. "You cannot love her," she cried. "You belong to me, and I belong to the sea, and you will love the sea more than her." And at a moment where the man had been, he was no longer. Though his shoes and the shoes of his love lay in the sand with water in them. They say to this day that Oceana keeps the man by her side always, and that the angered waves that hit against lovers on the beach are the waves of the man who is angered that his love was taken from him, and the other waves that pull those waves back are Oceana keeping the man she loves away from escaping and close to her forevermore. I hope that story was okay. I haven't had the chance to tell it before. It's a little upsetting for the younger children. Though I do hope you enjoyed it. Oh, I didn't realize it was getting so late. I must be going. Though, I would love to tell you another story sometime. You'd like that? Oh, how brilliant. Well, until next time, I'll see you around. Goodbye.